Morning, ladies and gentlemen. Greetings from Bhubaneswar. I welcome all the delegates, all the speakers, and all the chairpersons and moderators for this session in Hall A. The first session is the guest lectures, and the moderators are Dr. Lokendra Singh, Unnar Yuman, and Dr. Bartik Diura. I request the moderators to take over the guest. Probably Dr. K. Sridhar is not there. All other speakers are available, and you can start to Professor N. Muthukumar. Over to the moderators, please. Good morning once again.
Morning. Good morning, sir.
Morning, Manas.
First speaker is Dr. Muthukumar. He is going to talk about the spine in Morpheus disease. Dr. Muthukumar.
Can you play my recorded presentation? Tech team. Good morning. At the outset, I'd like to thank the organizers of this meeting for this opportunity to share some of my experiences with you today. Today, I'll be talking to you about a rare disease known as Morpheus disease, which is one of the types of mucopolysaccharidosis. Today, I'll be focusing on the CB junction pathology in children with Morpheus disease. As we know that Morpheus disease is an autosomal recessive disease, which is due to mutations of the GALNS gene, which encodes N-galactosamine 6 sulfatase. The reduction of this enzyme results in faulty catabolism of keratin and chondroitin sulfate, both of which get accumulated in the tissues and organs, leading to tissue and organ dysfunction. As we know, the keratin and chondroitin sulfate, they constitute the significant portion of extracellular matrix and cartilage. Therefore, children with this disease, they tend to have significant skeletal dysplasia. There are certain diagnostic challenges in children with Morpheus disease, like other children with skeletal dysplasia. Myelopathic features can be masked or disguised by the associated musculoskeletal disease, rendering the diagnosis difficult. And one of the hallmarks of Morpheus disease is that most common cause of cervical myelopathy in these children is atlantaxial dislocation. And in this particular situation, it's worthwhile to note the routine dynamic X-rays which we are taking in children with Morpheus for diagnosis of atlantaxial dislocation will not be useful in Morpheus because of the severe odontoid hypoplasia that is almost universally present in these children, as well as due to the bifid anti-rash, both of which I will demonstrate in the index cases, which I will show subsequently. Because the radiological parameter for diagnosis of AAD is the atlanto-dense interval, this cannot be used in children with Morpheus disease. And moreover, surgery in Morpheus disease itself is challenging because of the severe short stature. Once again, I'll showing it by an example. The skeletal deformity, especially the short neck and the exaggerated thoracic kyphosis, and the young age at surgery, which limits our instrumentation options. And very important to note that anesthesia in this patient is very tricky sometimes because these children are known to have tracheal stenosis, which may vary anywhere between 25 to 70% of the diameter of the trachea, which makes intubation extremely difficult and even dangerous. There are also several controversies as far as Morpheus is concerned because there are no guidelines for surveillance policies, when surgery should be done, whether it should be based on radiological or clinical signs of myelopathy, whether it should be only decompression or fixation, or if it is fixation, the type of fixation. The first case is a 12-year-old male who presented to us with spastic quadriceps, short neck, pectus carinatum, and corneal clouding on ophthalmic examination. This child had significant odontoid hypoplasia, atlantaxial dislocation, platy spondylia, anterior beaking of the thoracic vertebrae and lumbar vertebrae known as bullet vertebrae. And the axial CT at the CBGA shows a bifid anterior rash as well as a bifid posterior rash. In this particular child, we chose to do a Goel's procedure by doing a CNC diffusion, and the intraoperative photograph shows the bifid posterior rash. We did an uneven full C1C diffusion using screws and rods. Those are the postoperative images which shows the screws and rods in situ after Goel's fusion. And that's the post-op coronal and axial CT showing both the C1 and C2 screws in situ. That's the patient 2 weeks post-op. Please note these children have significant skeletal dysplasia, contracture of the lower extremities, genu valgum, etc. So these children will require several orthopedic procedures later. Case 2 is a 6-year-old female who was bedridden due to spastic quadriparesis. She had a short neck, but there was no positive family history. And her radiological parameters showed features of atlantaxial dislocation. And the other radiograph showed bullet-shaped vertebrae in the rest of the spine. And this is the CT of the spine, which shows not only odontoid hypoplasia, but significant bifid anterior as well as posterior arch of atlas, which basically in this child, the atlas was bipartite. And this MRA showed significant compression at the cervicomedullary junction with significant intramedullary signal changes. This is the intraoperative photograph of this child, which shows the bifid anterior and bifid posterior arch of atlas. So what we did in this particular child was that we did a transarticular screw fixation. And because both the arches of atlas were bifid, basically this child had a bipartite atlas, we connected the two transarticular screws using a horizontal cross connector and supplemented it with the rib graft to achieve bone effusion. That's the post-operative image, which shows the two transarticular screws. And that's the post-op CT, which shows the sagittal recon, which shows the transarticular screws in situ. And that's the child 2 months post-op who was bedridden. She was able to stand and walk with support. And 1 year later, she was able to walk with support independently. And it is important to note, the gait in these children may not look normal because of the associated skeletal dysplasia. The third case is a 6-year-old male who was presented with significant spinal deformities, spastic quadriparesis, short neck, and pectus carinatum. Notice the practically there is no neck for this child. Significant pectus carinatum, exaggerated thoracic kyphosis, and other features of Marcus disease. And the radiograph shows the classical bullet-shaped vertebra. And this is the CT, which shows the bifid anterior and posterior arch of atlas, like the one we saw earlier. It's a bipartite atlas, and there's odontoid hypoplasia. Also note there is kyphosis at the cervicothoracic and thoracolumbar junction, which can become sites of compression at a later date as the child grows older. And there is odontoid hypoplasia. This child had odontoid hypoplasia as well as bifid anterior and posterior arch of atlas. And the MRA showed significant compression at the cervicothoracic junction. This child was operated under intraoperative neuromonitoring. In this child, first we attempted a transarticular screw fixation, which was not possible because of the short neck and the thoracic kyphosis. We then moved on to a C1 CT fusion, which could not be done because of the pectus carinatum. The intrathoracic pressure increased, and that led to significant engorgement of the C2 venous plexus and blood loss. And when we went to the third option of occipitocervical fusion, the subaxial lateral mass screws pulled out. And eventually, we had to do an occipital C2 fusion using C2 translaminar screw on one side and the C2 pass screw on the other side. That's the post-op CT, which shows the C2 pass screw on one side and the C2 translaminar screw on the other side. That's a post-op construct. And that's the boy, 8 months post-op. Was walking normal. Please note once again, these children will not have normal gait, normal appearing gait because of the skeletal dysplasia. When you come to the review of the literature, the largest series is the MARCAP study, which studied 325 patients, and they found that more than 50% of the patients have got compression. The most common site of compression being the craniovertebral junction, and the prevalence of the compression increases with age. The cervicothoracal compression, which is at the craniovertebral junction, is maybe due to the atlantaxial dislocation, which is both due to odontoid hypoplasia as well as due to the laxity of the transverse ligament, or it may be due to the accumulation of this keratin and chondroitin sulfate and as a retroodontoid pseudotumor. The indications for surgery have varied widely, and in fact, we have come a full circle now. Early in 1990s, Alan Crawford and colleagues from Queen Square suggested that every child with Marcus should undergo a prophylactic fusion. But in between, in the 2010s and 13, there are some studies which suggested some relative and absolute indications as noted here. But as we shall be seeing later, in the recent publications, once again, we are going towards prophylactic fusion. There are many guidelines for surgery in children with Marcus disease. Most important should be preferably the surgery should be done under intraoperative neuromonitoring because of the high risk of deterioration. And intubation is extremely difficult in children, as I mentioned earlier, because of the short neck as well as due to the tracheal stenosis. And it's important to know there are several reports of sudden death or even a trivial trauma causing quadriplegia in children, which once this happens, once the child becomes quadriplegic, the improvement will not be good. So prophylactic fusions are recommended nowadays when there is even a radiological evidence of atlantaxial dislocation. As I mentioned earlier, flexion extension radiographs are not useful. If necessary, carefully flexion extension MRIs can be done. And extremely important to know that 40% of children or even up to 70% in some series can develop compression either at the cervicothoracic or thoracolumbar levels later years, about 5 to 10 years later. And this study from UK studied the mortality in Marcus disease from 1980 to 2010. They found that over a period of 20, 30 years, the mortality significantly improved. In fact, in recent years, after the advent of enzyme replacement therapy, the mortality would have significantly decreased. We don't have data for that as of now, but what is to be noted is that enzyme replacement therapy, unfortunately, does not influence the course of the cervical junction pathology. There are two important studies, both published in 2018, which I am going to refer now. And this study is from Manchester, which was published in Child's Nervous System. Among the 82 patients with Marcus, they had to perform surgery in nearly one third of patients. And most important is these children seem to require surgery at the age of 6 years. And the most important point to take home from this study is that they noted only patients who were clinically asymptomatic but had radiological compression. They were the only patients who improved after surgery. Once the patient develops myelopathy, once the patient becomes clinically myelopathic, the patients very rarely improve. And therefore, they recommended surgery before the patient becomes myelopathic when there is radiological evidence of compression. And another important finding in this study is that 3/4 of children will develop compression, at least radiological evidence of compression at subjacent levels 7 to 8 years after surgery. Another study in the same year, 2018, this time, it was from Adelaide, Australia, published in Spine. They treated 26 patients, 18 were treated operatively. And once again, the most important point to note is surgery seems to be required at around the age of 6 years, like two of our three patients require surgery around this age only. And once again, like the previous study, these authors also noted that only patients who had radiological evidence of compression without clinical myelopathy, they are the patients who maintain their neurological status and improve. Once the patient develops clinical myelopathy, improvement rarely, if ever, occurs. So concluding, children with Marcus disease are at high risk of developing atlantaxial dislocations and subsequent myelopathy. It's important to remember myelopathic features in these children may be masked by associated musculoskeletal disease. Therefore, a high index of suspicion is required to diagnose this condition. And surgery should be done when there is radiological evidence of compression before the advent of clinical myelopathy to have good results. Children at high risk should undergo prophylactic fusion, but just operating is not enough. These children should be followed lifelong, because lifelong there's a chance of developing compression either at cervicothoracic or thoracolumbar level. Therefore, these children should be followed at least in 6 month intervals, and they should undergo repeat MRI at yearly intervals. Thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Muthukumar, for an excellent presentation of a very rare disease causing atlantoaxial instability. Do we have a questions from the audience or faculty members?
May I ask a technical question? Dr. Onur speaking here.
Yes, Dr. Onur.
Muthukumar.
Yes.
Congratulations, very good cases. A technical question. Most of the cases are childs and... what's the diameter of your screws that you're using there?
Pardon?
What's the diameter of the screws that the youngest, you're using?
The youngest child I have operated with Marcus is six years, And up to 5 years, I have found it is possible to use 3.5 mm screws. When I operated these three patients, that was the smallest diameter screws that was available. Now there is an Indian manufacturer who has come out with a 3 mm screw. Probably in future cases, if required, for example, if I have to place in C2 pass is very small in children, so it will not have a good purchase. So if I have to place a C2 translaminar screw on that, and the last third case, I use C2 translaminar screw on one side. Fortunately, the lamina was thick enough, but lamina is not thick enough. I think now it is possible to use a 3 mm screw. At that time when I operated that patient, we didn't have a 3 mm screw.
Yeah.
So up to 5 and a half years, it is possible to use 3.5 mm screw. Below that, I think we have to go for other options like cables and autologous scraps.
Thank you.
Yeah, Professor Muthukumar, yeah. What is the longest follow-up in your patients? You operated three patients.
Right? These three patients were followed, longest follow-up was only for 2 years. See what happens, as you know very well, in a country like India, once they improve, they come for follow-up for 6 months, 1.5 years, and after that they think they are normal. They don't turn up until they develop a problem. So they just come for follow-up, and after 2 years, I have not been able to follow up these patients. And that doesn't mean that these patients do not require follow-up. I do want to follow them, but literature shows that this patient should be followed lifelong. For a want of time, I didn't mention, there have been some recent publications where the Marcos patients have become symptomatic in adult age group, even as late as 40 years of age. So it can develop at a very late age also. I just wanted, even though this is rare, I just wanted to highlight, because first time when such a patient came, I was at a loss. I had to read a lot before I could operate on this patient.
Another thing, do this patient, you mentioned something about medical management.
Yeah.
So does this patient require some sort of a medical treatment?
There is an enzyme replacement therapy, which was a trial was going on for some time, but unfortunately, I don't think that that was done in India, and I am not aware. I just know the theoretical basis of that. I have no practical experience with enzyme replacement therapy, because to the best of my knowledge, it was not done in India.
Thank you.